Hello everyone, welcome to Let's Talk World Talk show presented by Clickaway Creators. Today we have Mr. Santosh Sharma with us. Mr. Sharma is a versatile professional with keen eye and interest towards the insolvency and bankruptcy laws. He has a strong background of 18 years with experience in corporate law and commercial law practices. He has been instrumental in advising national and multinational corporations for formulation of strategy on efficient management, marketing, debt, restructuring, and infrastructure advisory. He has also advised several resolution professionals in effective discharge of their duties under corporate insolvency resolution process. So, hello, Mr. Sharma. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you, Nikhil, for this wonderful introduction. It's my honor to be part of this interview.
Thank you, Mr. Sharma. So, Mr. Sharma, please tell us about the complex legal issue that you worked on and describe the complexity and tell us how you actually approached it.
So one main issue I remember on which we have worked is pendency of cases. The first and the biggest problem is of the delay in disposition of cases. Due to huge pendency, the cases takes years for its final disposals, which would normally take few months time. The areas cause delay, and delay means negating the accessibility of justice in true terms of to the common man. The very core of a civil society and rule of law is the provision of justice, but the decision must be delivered within a reasonable time. It's totally unfair if a suspected criminal waits for trial for years and is ultimately found innocent. Similarly, the victim of the crime will be also not satisfied if there is no punishment to the criminal for so long. Only speedy justice could ensure effective maintenance of law and order. Quality of justice not only promotes peace in the society, but also strengthen the internal security of the country. There are number of litigations which could be avoided if government officials had taken interest. For example, Section 80 of CPC requires a prior notice of 2 months to the government by a party who wish to sue the government. The purpose of this section is to give time to government to settle the matter with such party by taking proper and suitable action, and thereby could avoid unwanted and unnecessary litigation. But the utter failure of the government officials in taking a quick, bold and suitable action in spite of giving time forces a person to file suit. So for this cause, we have fought in the Supreme Court in a criminal appeal in the matter of Ratan Singh versus State of MP, whereby Honorable Supreme Court laments the pendency of criminal appeals before the High Court and further demanded action plan from the center and states regarding the appointment of ad hoc judges so that the justice could be done with the aggrieved parties. So in my opinion, presently the pendency of cases is a burning issue, and there is an urgent need to come together the all stakeholders to resolve this issue.
All right. Now, Mr. Sharma, how would you rate the current legal system's drive towards encouraging access to justice? Is there a tangible movement in closing the justice gap?
So in my opinion, the government and the judiciary collectively to take immediate initiative in order to do the justice. The infrastructure of the lower court is very disappointing. Apart from this, competency of the court, other court staffs in courts, it should also be keep in mind that not only judges and advocates be competent, but also the administrative and clerical staff. The clerical staff must be free from all type of corruptions. This is the era of computerization. The highly technical and competitive clerical staff will also help in speedy courts. Moreover, the delay by investigative agencies is also a factor. The investigation of crime, it is generally heard that the accused gets bail as the investigating agency failed to submit charge sheet within the statutory period. The combination of several functions such as criminal investigation, riot control, intelligence gathering, and security of VIPs by a single police force has a devastating effect on the criminal justice system. Nowadays, the criminal investigation is not immune from the partisan politics. The power of the government to drop criminal charges against the accused has further abused it. The lethargic police investigation is also ground of slow process of law. So yes, of course, a lot of work is still to do to make more efficient to the judicial system of India.
All right, I completely understand that. And now, what do you think about the involvement of insolvency laws and their sustainability in India?
So, it is a smarter to have one systematized enactment than various ones to manage the defaults of one organization under one umbrella. This is the exact rationale behind the presence of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code in India, which has been put to the effect since 2016. The Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code took birth by repealing Sikh Industrial Company Act, that is SICA, which was revoked with impact from 1st December 2016. So slip up of the past were taken into account and the IBC appeared with a broader reach, with a goal of addressing the issues through more efficient guidelines and executions. It is an act to amend and reform laws whose subject matter has problems of reorganization and insolvency resolutions. So general objects of this of insolvency law in India is, the first objective is the predictable, equitable and transparent allocation of risk among participants in a market economy. So the accomplishment of this objective plays a critical role in giving trust to the credit system and promoting economic growth for the benefits of all participants. From instance, as regard the creditor-debtor relationship, a creditor's ability to initiate insolvency proceedings against a debtor as a mean of enforcing his claim, reducing the risk of lending, and thus increases the availability of credit and investment making. So an indebtedness law likewise served to designate hazards among different creditors, additionally to assist borrowers. For instance, if the indebtedness law affords secured creditors uncommon treatment opposite to unsecured creditors, such treatment ensures the estimation of security, which might be especially significant for those accounts holders, and in view of these credit hazard, can't get unsecured credit. And the second goal of an indebtedness law is to insecure and boost an incentive to serve every stakeholder and the economy at large. So most evidently, this goal is pursued during rehabilitation or restoration, where value is maximized by continuing a viable business, but it's also a primary purpose of procedures that liquidation companies that cannot be restored. The accomplishment of the value maximization object is regularly promoted by the satisfaction of the target of equal distribution of risk. For instance, the annulment of fraudulent transactions that took place prior to an insolvency process guarantees that lenders are treated equally and thus increases the value of the debtor's property assets. So a portion of the key policy decision that need to be made when structuring an insolvency law, identifying how the above goals are adjusted against one another. Moreover, decisions should be made on who will the recipient of the worth that is maximized. It is important to avoid each stereotype when we find a way to strike the balance between the various targets described above. Indebtedness individuals are not always fraudulent or incompetent, and creditors are not always selfish and understanding. As borne out by ongoing experience, in spite of the fact that organizations may fail in view of the incompetence, they may likewise come up short on account of financial challenges outside their ability to control. Yes.
All right. That was very nicely explained again. So, Mr. Sharma, what do you think about the cross-border insolvency regime in India and the way forward? Please explain.
So, usually, a situation concerning cross-border insolvency arises when the debtor has assets or creditors in different jurisdictions, or when different insolvency proceedings have been filed in multiple jurisdictions. As such, the mechanism pertaining to cross-border insolvency is primarily focused towards regulating the insolvency proceedings that operates much beyond the realm of domestic jurisdictions and the constraints therein. Broadly speaking, the following aspects are involved in a cross-border insolvency. Number one, equal protection of the interest of domestic and foreign creditors. Secondly, safeguards the value of the assets of a debtor which are located in different jurisdictions. Third, coordination and cooperation amongst courts and judicial authorities in various jurisdictions and the domestic laws applicable therein. And the last but not the least, uniformity in the insolvency law and practices of different jurisdictions. In the primary legislations governing insolvency and bankruptcy is the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. However, even though the code has made strides in drastically harmonizing the insolvency process in India, it does not account for sufficient procedure to regulate cross-border insolvency proceedings. The code offers two provisions that assist in cross-border insolvency disputes, that is Section 234 and Section 235. Section 234 of the code empowers the central government to enter into bilateral agreements with other countries for purpose of enforcing the code. And on other part, Section 235, the code empowers the adjudicating authority under the code to issue a letter of request to a court in a country in which an agreement under Section 234 has been entered into to deal with assets situated in that country in a specific manner. So conclusively, we can say that the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, that is Unicitral Model Law, in essence, provides a fairly independent framework which allows the concerned jurisdiction to evaluate and thereby decide the operational nitty-gritty best suited to that country legal landscape. As such, the Unicitral Model Law offers a wide scope of benefits and clarity, that is, in cross-border insolvency disputes. However, as highlighted above, the presently there exists not much of a legal framework for addressing cross-border insolvency disputes in India. Even if the two provisions are provided in the country, in the court, are notified and implemented, they suffer from various shortcomings and would not be able to provide a comprehensive mechanism for cross-border insolvency proceedings. In January 2020, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs of India had constituted a special committee to further understand and recommend the necessary rules and regulations framework for smooth implementation of proposed cross-border insolvency provisions in the code. However, there does not seem to be many updates on the progress made by the said committee regarding their work on the inclusion of cross-border insolvency provisions in this code. Having said that, it cannot be ignored that a lot of procedural and legal challenges would have to be addressed for the effective adaptation and implementation of the draft chapter. However, once the hard work is carried out and the hurdles are met, the legal framework could ensure cooperation and communication between the different jurisdictions and successfully address the resolution of cross-border dispute concerning India. That's it.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing such great insights with us. We look forward to having a chat with you again in the future on some other trending topics. And for our viewers, if you like this chat with Mr. Santosh Sharma, please like and share this video as much as you can. And also subscribe to ClickAway Creators YouTube channel to appreciate what we do. And you have more coming from the legal space. So this is Nikhil for Lex Talk World signing off. Thank you.